Okay. Sip on the tea for dramatic effect. Ow, it's hot. Last week we learned that the Romans saved Paul from being killed by the Jews after giving his testimony, after giving the testimony of his conversion. He also talked about the healing of Ananias, and probably the worst offense, or at least the one that the Jews reacted to, was that he claimed he was sent to the Gentiles. Why that was the most offensive, I'm not sure, but that is a point that I suspect was made. Okay, they then decided they were going to punish him after the Romans saved him from the Jews and were getting ready to scourge him. And then he revealed his Roman citizenship. At that point, the best description of their reaction was they were terrified. The commander released him, but he also wanted to investigate why the Jews wanted to kill him, because it was his responsibility at that point to protect Paul. So now we're going to pick up, probably the next day, though I don't think it specifically says that. Actually, it does. I just forgot. We're picking up the next day where the Romans want to investigate it, and he is back in front of the Sanhedrin, the same folks that he had been with the night before, or at least a large part of the same people. And we are going to start reading chapter 23. We're not going to get terribly far this week, so next week we'll be doing more of a blitz session, but I really liked these first 10 verses, so that's what we're going to read now. Then Paul, looking earnestly at the council, said, "Men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day." And the high priest Ananias commanded those who stood by him to strike him on the mouth. Then Paul said to him, "God will strike you, you whitewashed wall, for you sit to judge me according to the law, and you command me to be struck contrary to the law?" And those who stood by said, "Do you revile God's high priest?" Then Paul said, "I did not know, brethren, that he was the high priest. For it is written, 'You shall not speak evil of a ruler of your people.'" But when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, "Men and brethren, I am a Pharisee." "The son of a Pharisee. Concerning the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am being judged." And when he had said this, a dissension arose between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. For Sadducees say that there is no resurrection and no angel or spirit, but the Pharisees confess both. Then there arose a loud outcry, and the scribes of the Pharisees' party arose and protested, saying, "We find no evil in this man, but if a spirit or an angel has spoken to him, let us not fight against God." Now, when there arose a great dissension, the commander, fearing lest Paul might be pulled to pieces by them, commanded the soldiers to go down and take him by force from among them and bring him into the barracks. Tonight, I want to talk to you about risk. And you're either going to be blessed or cursed by that, because I was listening and actually talking about that this last weekend. And that's what hit me in this. So you might have a slightly different take than you normally would. If we look at the circumstances of Paul in these two chapters, he's really SOL. And since we're in church, that's an acronym for short of luck. But he's in trouble. He has no power in the situation that he's in. And Paul is, once again, in this chapter, in the hands of the guys that were planning on killing him the night before. He does now have Roman soldiers watching out for him, because they found out he was a Roman citizen, but we can hardly consider them his allies. To them, Paul is a troublemaker, and they're there to find out what kind of trouble he's causing. So in this precarious situation, Paul initially responds calmly, maybe even lovingly, calling the Sanhedrin his brothers, and defends his actions, saying that he has lived in good conscience before God. And that's going to be our first life lesson, because when I read that phrase, not for the first time, but it hit me as a, wow, that really resonates. I like the way that sounds. I want to live in good conscience before God. So, life lesson number one, live your life in good conscience before God. Unfortunately, that's the only short life lesson tonight. So that one you can memorize and deal with the rest of your life. The rest of them you might have to refer back to. What is good conscience? And I will be asking questions tonight, and you can respond, and I'll repeat them for the folks that aren't here. But good conscience, I mean, we all sort of know what that means, but what is your conscience? Where does it come from? Anybody? Here I am sounding. Okay. Moral, spiritual habits that you learn. If you haven't learned it, can you have a good conscience? Oh, okay. You're right. But a conscience. Okay. God's law written on our hearts. Conscience normally has a positive connotation. I mean, a bad conscience is when your conscience, which is good, is hurting you because you've done something bad. But at least my understanding of the word is, it is, to me, the whisperings of the Holy Spirit. And we're going to get to sinning very shortly, but that's one of the things that really hit me there. And a good conscience means that you can sleep at night. You don't have anything you regret from the day of your activities. And that's an ongoing basis. I can do something today that'll bother me for 5 minutes, or for 5 days, or 5 weeks, or 5 years, or the rest of my life. And that is something that is part of our conscience, and how long we're conscious of it. I'm going to trip over my words, I'm sure, before this is done. But how long we are really recognize and have something on our conscience, we say, there I did it, is related to both, as Steve put it, you know, how we brought up, how strong our moral integrity is, but also, you know, how serious an offense it was. And there are basically two reasons your conscience can be bad, or you'll have problems with your conscience. The first one, and most obvious, is sin. Now, how many of you think you commit sins unknowingly? Anybody? I'll raise my hand, I'll give you a hint. We all do. But are those going to sit on our conscience unless God brings them to our attention? Are we going to struggle with the sins that we did unknowingly if we don't recognize our sins? So that's not going to be part of living a life in good conscience. Now, how many of you sin on purpose? And you probably don't want to raise your hands there, but I have to, if I'm going to be honest, and hopefully, and this isn't to embarrass you, but to recognize we are all sinners. Now, when we sin knowingly, and I find it interesting that we make such a distinction between having a sin that we're constantly doing or having a sin we just choose to do now and then. Jesus died for all of those. But we do sometimes say, well, that's much worse because you're smoking every day, or you're drinking every day, or you're lusting every day. But most of our sins, especially the ones we're not as aware of, we are doing continuously. The other way you have a problem with having a good conscience is a distorted self-image. Now, we are all sinners. I think we established that. And if we look at ourselves in the light of, you know, the worm that I am, the person nobody would like if you knew what I was really thinking, if that is the context where you look at yourself, your conscience is going to bother you. If you remember that you're the beloved son of the creator of the universe, and that he's forgiven you, and he sees you cloaked in the righteousness of Christ, it's going to be hard for you to live in a context that doesn't give you a good conscience. Because first of all, a daddy like that loves you, you're not going to want to displease. So when you do sin, you're going to regret it, be forgiven of it, and go forward in that righteousness of God. So what do we do about either of them? What do you do when you do something you knew you shouldn't, but you really wanted to, and do it anyway? Hey, what, for having all these elders and pastors in here, this isn't a very bold group. You don't want to talk about your sin, huh? Yeah. Yeah. And there are folks that think that because I have accepted Jesus, I don't sin anymore. But we don't believe that here. If you do, we can talk later. But one thing I do is sort of what I just said. You know, our sin, we can sin against other people, and it usually does have that component. And we should ask their forgiveness to get past that. But all of our sin, as David wrote, is against God. And if you're doing something to hurt the daddy that loves you more than you can understand, and that you supposedly love, how often can you do that and not try to change your behavior? Now, I'm going to quote somebody I love to listen to, and this is, at least to me, a truth. I don't know that I could support it biblically, but it sure sounds good when I say it and hear it. And what Steve Brown says, and he is a biblical scholar, so he's probably researched it, and it's at least not against anything you're going to find in the Bible. But he says that the only people that get any better are those that realize if they don't get any better, God will love them just as much. When we're trying to do it because we're going to be good in our own righteousness, we fail miserably. Just the same. I'm paraphrasing because I'm terrible at memorization. You should remember that from being around when I was at SOD. So, but that is what we do with our sin. What do you do with your broken self-image? Does anybody really feel like you're the scum of the earth and you have no business being here and you're unlovable and unloved? You don't have to raise your hands. If you do, stop it. Because the creator of the universe, God, loved you so much that Jesus, part of the Godhead, came and took on himself all of your sins so that you could be righteous in the presence of a perfect God. And if you're loved that much, well, I'll share a very quick story. I was feeling guilty when I was in clinical pastoral education, which is an intense series of what are called units, but each unit is 3 months, and I did 5.5 total. And during that time, you are getting picked on by mostly solid Christians and a few weirdos. Well, maybe mostly weirdos and a few Christians. I never totally figured it out. Definitely some weird Christians. But they are doing everything they can to mess with you, to root you in your faith and your belief. And I was feeling real bad about myself one day and was talking about, you know, well, are you reading the Bible? Not as much as I should, you know. Are you praying? No, I'm not praying much. Going through that series of things. And, you know, do you really feel bad about all these things you're not doing? And I was the one saying these, so I wasn't having them grill me on that. It was, you know, why are you struggling? I said, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that, I'm not performing like a Christian should. And a guy that I really didn't like that only occasionally showed up, but he was a jerk. And he was someone I considered as being arrogant. And that is a real, if you ever call me arrogant, you'll probably get a reaction, because that's something that, it's one of those things that I discovered at that moment that I was, but it's something I really hate in others. And often the sin that you see and bothers you most in others is your own. So anytime you can't figure something out with a relationship, and you know that really irritates me about them, look at yourself and see if that's a reflection of you, because sometimes it will be. But he, after I was sitting there practically in tears talking about how lousy a Christian I was, he says, you know, you're really arrogant. And I went from feeling sorry for myself to angry in a second. I didn't react in anger, fortunately, but I did say, why do you say that? And he said, well, you're saying that you know yourself better than God does, because God's forgiven you and you're not forgiving yourself, and that's arrogant. And so from that point on, I've been trying to forgive myself when I'm stupid, and that's frequent. But that is a major thing in trying to deal with your own sin. Because as we've established, we're all sinners, and we have to deal with it. And because of my technology problems, my pages aren't numbered and my lines aren't highlighted, so I may have some trouble reading here, but I think I might be in the right place. Or not. That's the last page. Oh yeah, that's what's next. I rambled too much, but the next thing I wanted to share with you, and you've probably heard half of this quote from Luther, and he did say something to the effect of, be a sinner and sin boldly. Has anybody heard that before? No? I've heard it more than once. Sometimes you'll just hear it, Luther said, sin boldly. And I'm pretty sure I've even heard it here. But that there's a comma there, not a period. And the rest of that is, but believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly. So Luther's not really telling us go out and sin, but he does say that, you know, if you're going to screw up, do it big time. Basically, that's my modern translation of Luther there. And know that God has your back, and you can rejoice in that boldness. And honestly, until I looked this up the first time, I had never heard it except the, you know, I usually heard it, if you sin, sin boldly. The if isn't there. It's be a sinner. You're going to be. So it's not if you sin. It's more of a when you sin. But believe and rejoice in Christ even more boldly. That speaks to both the sin and the self-image. It also speaks to our theme, risk. And we're going to get back to that now. So looking at Ananias' reaction to Paul's pretty tame statement there, he's either having a very bad day, or he still wants Paul dead after the previous encounter, and I suspect that is likely. Or there's something else going on that we're not aware of, or may be lost in the translation, or at least it's lost in the translation to me. Now, I didn't find anything to support that, but in life, and here might be a good time for another life lesson. Initially, when I was zipping through this, I didn't think about that, but this is a freebie here, and it's a long one. In communication, in relationship, and particularly in studying the Bible, if the response you see is way out of proportion with the stimulus, you can be sure that something else is going on. So when you ask your wife, "How are you, dear?" and she says, "Fine," does anybody not know what that means? There's something wrong, and you need to get deeper into that communication. And in this case, you know, he's saying, "Well, I'm trying to do the best I can to live a godly life," paraphrased. And Ananias has him hit. Now, does that seem like the proper response to that stimulus? Not to me. So in life, look for those things. And when somebody goes ballistic over something very minor, know there's something else going on, rather than just writing them off as being insane or a jerk or mean. In particular, if it's somebody in authority over you, you need to find a reason to see why you're getting that reaction. But that's your life lesson, and that one is written down for you, which I'll give you in a little bit. Now, why did Ananias have Paul struck after such a calm, even friendly opening? If you want to know, make a note of it and go digging, because that ended up hitting me as a rabbit trail that I didn't take the time to wander down. But if you do find something, I'd love to hear it. But back to risk, which is what Paul takes in a tremendous way with his response to being hit. What's his response there? Let's look at the text again. And this is starting with Paul's reaction to Ananias in verse 3 after he's been struck. "Then Paul said to him, 'God will strike you, you whitewashed wall. For you sit to judge me according to the law, and do you command me to be struck contrary to the law?'" Does Paul sound angry to you there? Maybe a little bit. And it is okay to respond. I like response. Lets me know you're not asleep. Is that a sinful response? Is this particular instance a sinful response? I know none of us want to call Paul a sinner, but he was. But do you think there's sin in this response? Okay, the definitive answer is maybe. We don't really have enough information. This could be a righteous, indignant response to an injustice, and Paul isn't worried about himself. And that, to me, is the defining characteristic of sinful anger. If you're upset because it's about you, that's probably sinful anger. If you're upset because a child is being beaten by his mother in the grocery store, your response in anger may not be pure, but that response of wanting to protect those that are weaker is a pure and a godly type of anger. Now, I try to avoid anger at all costs because I was brought up in that in my home, and I can't remember ever being angry where part of it wasn't about me. Even in that situation, I want to be a hero, and I'm mad because I'm not going to interfere with that parent and raising their child. So I can turn it into being about me, even when it is a initially righteous response. So be careful with your anger. But Paul obviously was not. I mean, again, look at his situation. He is basically cursing the guy that could and wanted to have him put to death. So we want to recognize how high a risk that was that he was taking there. And looking at where I got lost, because I don't have my little yellow highlights, and I mentioned that came out as a curse, and it was. But if you remember, Jesus did a few things like that too. But if I were there with Paul, my immediate response to him would have been, I'm not sure I would have said that, because that could have quickly turned very ugly. How many of us, I guess I already admitted I probably wouldn't, but we would be willing to risk displaying our anger and responding as boldly as Paul did there? Has anybody got that kind of strength of will? And you probably won't. Thank you. Good answer. If you say no like I did, then you almost certainly won't. But if you don't know, if you go into the situation and you're responding to God, he's going to give you what you need at that time. And I'm sure that's where Paul was getting the boldness here. Now, the question after his exclamation, and you got an exclamation and a question there, and I won't go into that much, but I love how often the most profound things you read in the Bible are questions, not statements. Jesus invariably, I mean, he said he had many statements, and when he was teaching, that's what he was doing, but when he was doing one-on-one, most of his conversation was asking questions. And Paul did that here. And for me, it was a very clever one. Can one properly judge someone according to the law if they do not keep the law themselves? Is basically what he was asking. And, you know, that would make me think if I was sitting in judgment over Paul. And that pointing out the hypocrisy for me was very reminiscent of some of Jesus's encounters with the priests, scribes, Pharisees, Sanhedrin. He would often ask questions that questioned their authority without actually resisting their authority. Now, I'm not asking you to step up and start resisting the authority of pastors or anyone else with authority over you. Particularly with pastors, that would be kind of masochistic of me since I am one. But we all need to be bold and take the risk to confront injustice when we encounter it. And that is what he was doing here. And our next verses lead us to the next life lesson. Starting in verse 4, and those who stood by said, do you revile God's high priest? And then Paul said, I did not know, brethren, that he was the high priest, for it is written, you shall not speak evil of the ruler of your people. Now, this isn't long after Paul curses the guy. But despite being in something of an angry rant, he receives and responds to correction and even supports that with scripture. This also points to Paul's integrity. Because earlier he stated he followed God in good conscience. How can you do that if you're not paying attention to what God requires of you? So knowingly speaking evil about the ruler would be evidence that he was not honest about his relationship with God when he first spoke. Now, again, another question to embarrass you. How many of us can take correction in an emotional moment? Is that when you're ready for correction? Is when you're on fire angry? Not me. In fact, I regularly counsel people not to confront A until their anger has subsided some, or the hurt has subsided some. Now, there are things you have to do immediately, but expecting a highly emotional person to react rationally is not a reasonable expectation. But Paul did. And that's an exception we should all try to imitate. And the life lesson here is, regardless of the circumstances or our emotions, we need to always be willing to take correction. That's the toughest thing I've learned around here, and I'm still not sure I'm that good at it. But that is something that I have, and it's not because anyone here told me. God put that on my heart. And actually, I couldn't start here as a pastor until he dealt with my rebelliousness. And it still rears its ugly head now and then. But we're trying to whack that mole when he pops his head out. So Paul, in the midst of this confrontation, is taking the necessary risks to respond properly without taking unnecessary risks. Except maybe that curse. I still question that one. But he is evaluating the situation despite, I mean, when we are life or death situations, which he is, reason can flee from us. But he never loses his cool, so to speak. Yay, Paul. So, yay, I actually made it through here without losing any, I think. Yeah. Let's reread the next section, which I absolutely love. And this is why I didn't get it past verse 10 tonight. And I want you to pay very close attention to what Paul is doing here, starting in verse 6. But when Paul perceived that one part were Sadducees and the other Pharisees, he cried out in the council, "Men and brethren, I am a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee. Concerning the hope and resurrection of the dead, I am being judged." And when he had said this, a dissension arose between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. For Sadducees say that there is no resurrection and no angel or spirit, but the Pharisees confess both. Then there arose a loud outcry, and the scribes of the Pharisees' party arose and protested, saying, "We find no evil in this man. But if a spirit or an angel has spoken to him, let us not fight against God." Okay, was everybody listening carefully? Because here's the quiz. Now, I think I probably would not have been Paul's biggest fan if I were around in his time, because he's a bit edgy for my taste. But as I said, I absolutely love this section from both an intellectual and a strategic view. But before I say anything, what did you see in that section that Paul did? Anybody? Yes, sir. No, you're fine. Responding in a appropriate way. What else we see?
I sort of think he knew he was about to be in a whole heap of trouble. Like, let me just swing someone once more away from me and get out of it a little bit.
Yeah, when everybody is attacking you. I'm a bit of an armchair general. I've been playing war games since, well, before reaching puberty, but I don't know why that came out, but a long time, and I got pretty good at it. But what I saw here in Paul, and the reason I loved it so much, is A, he's brilliant, and B, his strategy is impeccable. Is Paul in warfare here? He is fighting for his life, but is this a battle? Do we see it as a battle? Yeah. And he handles that battle like a superb general. And his perception is the very first thing mentioned. He's paying attention. He's reading the enemy. And it really is the basis of his entire response, is how he perceives the folks he's in battle with. And yes, people sometimes represent the powers and principalities that we are in war with, but they are never supposed to be the object of our attack. It's fighting against what is controlling them, and that's exactly what he's doing here. But he studies his enemy, and he sees a weak spot. It's a way to turn them against one another. If he were fencing, which I did in college many decades ago, you'd call this a riposte. It's a response to an attack that, when they attack, everybody opens up a weak spot. When you're on the attack, you're not defending. So there is a place to respond in the attack, or a place to respond to that attack with a counterattack. And those can often be the most damaging attacks. Not the first I'm swinging at you, which actually you're not supposed to, but you stab. When you get to a saber, you don't want to know about fencing. Anyway, when you attack, you're exposing yourself, and they are attacking Paul. And he nails it with the riposte. And I don't speak French, so that is probably not the right way to pronounce it, but that's the way I learned it. It's really less of an attack than it is a brilliant defense. And he does it boldly, and it is a calculated risk. That place, as we will learn shortly, was in riot mode after that. And that's risky for everybody. But it works. He says he's being attacked because he believes in resurrection. And in a very short period of time, I think it might have been merely seconds, Paul goes from being the object of the attack to being able to step back and watch the divided enemy consume itself. That's a good way to win a battle. I really, at this point, suspect Paul is enjoying himself. I know I would be, and that might be sinful too, but that would be kind of fun to watch when your enemy is turned on itself. And for me, the final part here, having the Roman troops come in and whisk him away safely, was very anticlimactic. The battle had already been won, and that was just his escort out of there, though it looked like it was getting ugly. And one of the greatest victories the enemy has over us is convincing us that there is no battle. How many of us go through our daily lives as warriors, knowing that we're in battle? Or are we, and no slight intended, are we accountants and babysitters and all these other things we label it with that doesn't seem like it has anything to do with warfare? But if you have children, you are fighting for them, and babysitting becomes the job of a warrior. If your wife is crying and you have to console her, that requires a lover who is also a warrior. You are fighting for her heart every time she's in trouble. And if you're not, you're failing as your duty as a husband. Recognize that we are in a battle. And that kind of leads to the final life lesson. And I might be a little early, but that's okay. Life lesson number four, as we fight our daily spiritual battles, first weigh the risks, observe the enemy. I added that, you might have to too. And then boldly use all the weapons God has given you, the word, your mind, your strength, and your heart. And with that, let us close in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for the men here tonight, and I pray that you will renew their hearts and you'll give them the strength of the warriors you created them to be. And let them, as Paul was, boldly attack when that's called for, boldly, courageously defend when that's called for, and never be afraid to take the risk of doing the right thing. Most of us respond to risk as a negative thing, but nothing ever happens without some risk involved. And you are the great risk taker, because you created us not to do your will because we had to and that's the way you made us, but you created us with the free will to choose to love you or to choose to reject you. And Lord, let every day be filled with us making the right choice to follow you, to fight the good fight, and to be yours forever in the kingdom to come. We pray this in the one who has already won the war for us and left us to fight the skirmishes, our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.